and welcome back to my channel. We'll be talking about relationships. I know that a lot of bloggers, vloggers, preachers, social media influencers have talked about this, but I decided to do a little Q&A with friends and classmates to ask about relationships because aside from Valentine's, we are in that stage, especially for us within the teenage, young adult years, and I think that the heart and the mind are something that we have to really talk about, we have to understand how important they are, how influential they are in our lives, and how they affect us a lot. Okay, so first question says, what is the difference between attraction and admiration? So for me, I think that between the definitions already, attraction is more on looking at the tip of the iceberg. You're attracted to the way the person handles herself, aside from dressing, aside from looks, sometimes you're attracted by the way they speak to you, by the way they behave. But when it comes to admiring someone, for me, it's when you look at the totality of a person. It's like, it's not love, but it's a higher level compared to attraction. It's like you get attracted to someone, and then when you get to know them better, you admire them for who they are. I hope that answers the question. Next. If you see the signs that someone likes you and you search for confirmation, would you believe it? So personally, I think that, first of all, it's not really a big thing. Like, whether someone likes you or not, you have to be you. You have to work on growing yourself. You have to. What I tell my friends is, if you really want to get into a relationship, be sure that you're growing on your own. Because if he or she is growing and you're not growing, you're not going to be equally yoked in a relationship, which won't make it a very healthy one. So, even when you're single, like, it's important that you work on yourself. And then whoever is attracted, whoever admires you, whoever wants to pursue you, that's going to be their part. That's God and them. That's their conversation. I think that it's not really a matter of believing whether they like you or not. But first of all, we should just really work on ourselves so that we can reach that mature and wiser stage where we would know that if we've reached our mature and wiser stage and someone comes along and likes you, admires you, wants to pursue you, then you would be better off knowing how to say yes or no. So next, is it bad to hope when you know there's no hope? So this is such a big question because in the Philippines, we have this hugot thing, and like everyone's like emotional and regarding these kinds of questions. And this is a big question because my friends, it's kind of like you have a crush on someone, you're attracted and you admire someone, and you want to be with that person. And so yeah, they asked me, is it bad to hope when there's no hope? And for me, hope in itself is not bad. It's more on where you put it. Because you can hope for bad things to happen, so that's hope used in a wrong way. So hope itself is not bad. It's you. How are you hoping? Like, what is your position right now? If you're hoping for this relationship to happen, but you're not seeing anything, so how is your personal growth? How are you deep down inside? Because whenever it comes to relationships, this is not just the surface thing. It's not just about emotions. If you want a relationship so bad, it's not just going to be everything feels good. It's not just going to be like, I want to be with this person because he makes me feel good. Well, surprise, when you enter a relationship, not every day is going to feel good. Yes, they say that you can't have a relationship without arguing, which is true because there will always be times where you have to put those differences aside and then come to a conclusion on what you want to do together. But in this state where you're not together and you're hoping for something, it's kind of like, for me, I think you should really just focus on yourself, because if you grow in yourself first, you would know whether it's something to be pursued or not. Second, if it's meant to be pursued but you're not at the right time, then it's so much better if you just take a step back and look at everything. Because like I said, relationships are not just about feelings. They're gonna be you dealing with all the mess, stress, and everything that you're going through, plus someone else's mess, stress, and everything he or she's going through. So if you're hoping for something, make sure that you're in a right position already, that you're willing and ready to actually enter a relationship, to enter the commitment, the responsibility, because what you put your hope into is gonna affect you a lot. Like, if you hope for so much in a relationship, it's gonna affect the way you think, the way you feel, the way you react to things, and so you have to be careful where you put your hope in. So for me, it's not really bad to hope for something, it's just that if you can see that it's not gonna happen right now, I think it's better if you just focus on yourself and trust that God would bring the right timing with the right person too. So we have, why will we commit even if we have no label? So these questions were given by my classmates in the University of Mindanao. So I forgot who asked these, but they wanted a shout out. So to Lloyd and Meg and Maya, and I think those were the first ones who asked these questions, and Queenie and all, this is for you guys. So why will we commit even if we have no label? So first, I just want to say that I've been sharing this in church a lot. Lamentations 3:19-27. It says in verse 27 that it is good for a man to bear the yoke while he's young. So yoke means or represents responsibility. And it says it is good for us to have responsibility even at a young age. And I think the reason why a lot of people want to be with someone but don't want the label is because a label brings the responsibility that no one wants. And that's something that's actually not to be admired in couples, because like recently I found out that a celebrity, she's been with her partner for a long time and they have kids. And they're like a married couple, but they're not married. And I was shocked because, like, whoa! A lot of people who are married by contract don't commit or don't act responsibly upon the contract, while there are some who are not married but who actually act better or are more committed than those with the contract or with the paperwork. So that puts you into question, like, does it work better if there's no label so you feel more free to do things and it's not like you're not forced to do it? But for me, you always go back to the Bible. Like, being a Christian, being God's girl and His princess, waiting also for that time and place after school, whoever the person will be. It's like whenever there are decisions like this to be made, it has to go back to what God says. And for me, the way that I understand it is that God made marriage for a union between a man and a woman to be so beautiful. Because first of all, it's a representation of God to us. God loves us so much that He sent His one and only Son to us who are the bride, as it's said in the Bible. And that means that a bride is treasured and protected and cherished. And if we don't have the label, it's kind of like every part of love and cherishing that you give to that person is not full. It's like, even if you're trying to give all you can to that person without the label of responsibility or commitment, you're still not giving them everything. But see, commitment and all, yeah, you don't need a label to tell people that you're committed, but it's having a label that makes it verified. Like, when you have the label to say that you're married, that makes it so much more valuable. Like, if you're adopted, it makes it more valuable when it's written on paper that, hey, I'm legit, I'm a son, I'm a daughter of this family. Like, if you just believe that you're adopted but no one actually has proof about it, how would you feel? Okay, next question. In a relationship, why do you reach a point where you fall out of love? Well, so once again, these are from my other UM classmates who wanted to ask, help me out here. So first of all, if there's a thing as falling in love, I guess people believe there's a thing of falling out of love. But the way I was raised, which might be crazy sounding or not what everyone else believes, but I think that there's no way you can fall out of true love, because I've come to realize as I grew older that there are different kinds of love for people, but there's only one perfect love ever, and that's from God. You can read 1 Corinthians 13, 1 John 4, 8. There, it's like it's all there. There's proof that God is, He is love and He's a perfect love. So aside from that, what I realized is as people, we cannot give perfect love because we're not perfect. All we can do is love to the best that we can with the love that God gave us. And so I think that if we love people with our own ability, it's not always going to turn out the way we want. Because, like I said, we're limited. We don't have the unlimited, limitless love that God has. And if we don't have God, all the more our love would be limited. Like, I'm not saying that those who aren't Christians don't love each other. Like, you can see that there are people who are not Christians who love each other. But what I'm saying is based on experience, based on, like, looking at other people, my parents alone, my grandparents, my family at church, it's like you can see how when you have God in your relationship and you love with His love, it just makes things so much better. So I don't think it's really a matter of falling out of love. I think it's just loving the wrong person at the wrong time. Or what you thought was love is not love at all. Next. Does the means justify the end? So Clyde, I'll ask this. Does it apply in relationships? So what she asked was, if you start out well, does that mean you end up well? Well, just as in almost anything else, and just like in life, you can start out well and end wrong. You can start on the right path and end on the wrong path. You can start on a wrong path and end on a right path. So like I said, relationships all around the world, like I'm pretty sure even though some have like a similar story, no one has the same love story. So it really depends, as I keep mentioning, I really know this is important because what I tell my girls is, if you want a relationship, you gotta keep growing on your own right now while waiting. Because spiritually alone, like every aspect of life is included, but spiritually alone, if you are stagnant but your partner is growing, you're gonna be unequally yoked, meaning you're not gonna get on. You won't have the same pace, you won't have the same vision, you won't be on the same page, and that's going to be hard. And so when it comes to this, I think that it's important to start right, to journey it right, and then end right. So next question, is long distance a good reason to break? So this wasn't just asked by Jin, my other life group girl and classmate, for relationships between a couple, but it's all, she also meant friendships, because friendships are relationships as well. And for me, based on my experience, based on my parents' stories, no. Long distance is not the only reason or a valid reason for you to break up with someone, whether that's a friend or someone you're in a relationship with. Why? First of all, I've seen direct proof that long distance can also strengthen a relationship. My parents had long distance relationship for 5 years, if I'm not mistaken, within the 5 years. My mom was in America, my dad was here in the Philippines. So that's already direct proof for me. I know that you're never gonna